morning, everybody. Welcome to the Grove. We're excited to worship with you this morning. Would you stand with us and sing? From the rising of the sun.
From the rising of the sun to the ending of the day. One name alone be praised. Every nation, tribe, and tongue, all creation lifting up. Your name alone we raise. Praise the Lord, all the earth, all the earth. Bless His name, only one name, now and always. Jesus, you have rescued.
Take just a moment and say hello to those around you. Guys can go ahead and have a seat. Once again, I want to extend a special welcome to everyone, especially if you are a visitor with us. We're so glad you're here today joining us for worship. My name is Walter Hardiman. If we haven't met yet, I am the director of worship here at the Grove, and I'd like to just take a moment and kind of help you orient yourself a little bit to what's going on here today. First of all, hopefully you grabbed a program on the way in. There's some available just outside the doors if you didn't get one. If you want to go ahead and open that up, we can talk about what's going on in there. Inside, there's quite a bit of stuff happening at the Grove these days, and you can find out about all of that The most recent or most upcoming things are right there inside that folder. And there's also a note sheet you can use to follow along and participate with the message when Pastor Christian comes in just a minute. There's two other things I want to bring your direct your attention to, and depending on where you're sitting, they might be either on the floor if you're up here or in the seat back in front of you. The first of all, there is a giving envelope. That is for you to be able to help carry the mission of the Grove forward and contribute financially if that's something you're interested in doing. And then the other thing is a connection card. That connection card on the front, there's places where you can let us know your contact information, your name, email address, things like that. And then if you flip it over, there's also some places where you can let us know if you have any questions or prayer requests. We would love to be able to pray for you. That is a great way for you to start getting connected and start a conversation with us here at the Grove. So we'd love for you to fill that out. And then for both of those, both the giving envelope and the connection card, you can drop those off at the end of the service. There's an offering box right at the back there by the door. We want to continue to worship. I want to invite you to go ahead and stand. We're going to read our call to worship and then continue singing. So join with me as we read Psalm 24, verses 7 and 8. It says, "Lift up your heads, you gates. Rise up, ancient doors. Then the King of glory will come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty. The Lord, mighty in battle." I want to introduce a new song to you as we sing. So join in with us just as you feel comfortable. When all I see is the battle, you see my victory. The mountain, you see a mountain move, and as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. There's nothing impossible for you. And all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. And all I see is a cross, God, you see an empty tomb. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Shine in the shadow, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Shine in the shadow,
Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Shine in the shadow, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God.
You, the battle belongs to you today. You are mighty, and we worship you. God, would you hear us today? Would you come and be in this place, be here among us? We worship you, we give you glory, and we pray that you will speak through Pastor Christian as he comes. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. You guys can have a seat.
Well, good morning. Hey, if we have not yet had the pleasure of meeting, my name's Christian. I am the lead pastor here. We're so glad you're with us. We kicked off last week this series called The Armor of God. And as we're going through these next many weeks, looking at the end of a letter to the Ephesian church. Okay, it's called Ephesians. It's well named. And that letter was written by the Apostle Paul from a Roman prison. So here's this guy, Paul. He's been his life was radically transformed by this message of who Jesus was. He meets Jesus. God changes his life, and he begins to learn about what it is to walk with God. And then ultimately, God uses him in these mighty ways to see churches planted, see people come to know Jesus, and learn to walk with him. And part of his ministry was writing letters to these churches. And God uses that to give us much of what we have in the New Testament. And so here he is. He's been arrested because of his missionary work, and he's writing from a Roman prison. And as he's writing, what he would have been seeing are Roman soldiers who are guarding this prison, and they're walking about in the armor of a first century legionnaire. And you'll see this a little bit more later. But what Paul does is he uses this image that he's seeing of this first century legionnaire. He's using that image to explain this really important spiritual truth that we're going to be looking at over these next many weeks. We began last week. I want to review real quickly what we saw last week. We started Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. And we were told this: finally, be strengthened by the Lord and by his vast strength. Put on the full armor of God so that you can stand against the schemes of the devil. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this darkness, against evil spiritual forces in the heavens. For this reason, take up the full armor of God, so that you may be able to resist in the evil day, and having prepared everything, to take your stand. Okay. So that's where we started. And I gave us three big ideas we needed to take away in understanding this battle that we're talking about. We're talking about armor, but it's armor that's meant to be useful in a certain kind of battle. And so the three big ideas, you have them there on your listening guide if you want to follow along. But the three big ideas were this. One, we fight on an unseen front. Okay, the kind of battle we're talking about is not of flesh and blood. It has to do with supernatural. It has to do with Satan, the enemy. It has to do with demons. Those are the kinds of things we're talking about. Number two, God supplies us with his strength. So the way we're to fight this battle is to lean on the strength of God himself. His vast strength is at our disposal. And he's giving us his strength to prepare us And he's preparing us, this is the third thing, to prevail. He's preparing us to prevail. This is a battle, this is a war that we know Jesus has won. And yet we stand in this in-between place, this already but not yet, where there is still a certain dominion that this enemy has, a certain ability this enemy has to mess with us, to cause problems for us. And yet we can stand in the power of what Jesus has already done, okay? So we're being prepared to prevail, to experience all the fullness of what Jesus has already accomplished on the cross and through his resurrection. Now, I want to make a key point about the battle here that I didn't say, maybe you caught on to it, but I didn't explicitly say last week. And I want us to remember this. All those statements are we and us. This is not a battle. This is not an individual battle. Now, there are individual aspects of the battle. Okay, that's why we're doing this. You are individually impacted by this. But this is also meant to be a together kind of battle. This letter is addressed to the church. These instructions are addressed to the church. So the idea is that if you're learning to engage in this kind of sparring, this kind of struggle, that you're doing it knowing that you've got other people helping you, that you're not on your own trying to battle against these things, all just isolated, okay? So that's important to know. Now, another thing I want us to recognize is, what are we doing, what are we not doing? And very famously, author C.S. Lewis, he gives us this warning when we make our way to these kinds of, this topic in particular. He says this: there are two equal and opposite errors into which our race can fall about the devils, talking about the supernatural, demonic, that kind of thing. He says one error is to disbelieve in their existence. The other is to believe and to feel an excessive and unhealthy interest in them. They themselves, talking about the devils, the demons, are equally pleased by both errors and hail a materialist or a magician with the same delight. So on the one extreme, there's the materialist. There's the person who says that this is all bogus. There is none of this. Everything is physical. There is no supernatural. And so this is ridiculous to even talk about. On the other hand, the error is to be the magician, the person who is so fascinated by all of this thing that all they can do is think about it. And so using words that actually Walter gave this week as we were talking about this, our point here in this series is to avoid these two errors of being either obsessed or oblivious, okay? I don't want us oblivious. We got to understand there is a reality going on here, but we need to also avoid the error of being obsessed, because that's not what God calls us to when it comes to this topic. Instead, the point of this series is to make sure that we are properly outfitted. That's what God wants us. He wants us prepared. He wants us properly outfitted for this struggle, for this battle that we engage. Now, with all of that in mind, I want you to take a look at this quick video, okay? Just take a look, about a minute.
When you put your socks and shoes on, do you go sock, sock, then shoe, shoe, or sock, shoe, sock, shoe?
You put both socks on first, yeah, then you put your shoes on.
Sock, sock, shoe, shoe.
You're psycho if you do sock, shoe, sock, shoe. Robert would be the dude to do that.
Yeah, it's me.
I knew it!
Yeah, I go sock, sock, shoe, shoe.
Which order?
Whichever feeling the coldest. Wherever foot is feeling the coldest, that's where I put my sock on first.
Number 19, Keith Adams, goes sock, shoe, sock, shoe.
Sock, shoe, sock, shoe.
You're insane. What is wrong with you? Shoe,
let me answer this for Lucas.
He does not wear shoes.
Lucas, what we call a hippie.
I've started to do that. Sock, shoe, sock, shoe. I'm
Sock, 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 sock. Anybody who puts a sock and a shoe on, then has a bare foot, they need to be locked up.
I do that.
All right. So here's the thing. You now know what you'll be talking about at lunch, okay? I know that. What we're going to do today is take a look at a more important first dressing decision, okay? So you can keep that in mind, stick with your, you know, decide in your heart where what you are, which team, okay, you're on there. But we're going to look at a more important dressing decision, and we're going to turn to our first piece of armor. So I want to continue on, just real briefly, Ephesians 6:14, we're told this: stand therefore with truth like a belt around your waist. First piece of armor what we call the belt of truth. Now, again, another little warning or little pause here. Key point when we're talking about the armor, this is a metaphor. And when you have a metaphor, what happens sometimes is what we do with metaphors is we zoom in so closely on them that they stop being, we stop seeing what they're really all about. And so you have to be careful, because if you get caught up, we're going to look at subject today of truth. And in a few weeks, we're going to talk about the sword of the Spirit, which is, we're told, is the word of God. And next week, we're going to talk about the breastplate of righteousness. And what you're going to see is there's a lot of overlap in these ideas, because there's a unity to what's going on here. There's a unity to the armor. It's accomplishing a lot of the same things. And so if you get too worked up about, wait, how are these so different from one another? It will stop losing its helpfulness. Okay, so just be careful there. We're not trying to squeeze every little bit out of this metaphor in understanding. But this is, again, a helpful way for us to understand the nature of this battle and how do we trust God in the midst of just the stuff we face in life, the real stuff of life. Okay, and so what we're going to do for this and each piece of armor, in order to recognize the battle and be prepared to battle, is we're going to ask four questions. Okay, so you'll see there's these four questions. We're going to ask the same four questions each week of each piece of armor. So let's get started. First question is, what is it? Right? What is the belt of truth? Now, belts today, if you have a belt today, right, what do we use them for? Hold your pants up, right? I mean, that's what they're there for. That's good, yeah. Hold your pants up. Now, we also use belts for fashion, right? Sometimes it's really just there for show. It's just wanting to add a little pizzazz, right? It's an accessory. It can be that. We also still today use belts much like they would have used them back in this time. We still have belts that are used in for soldiers and for police officers and others, you know, who are doing work, and that's the kind of belt, a utility belt. That's the nature of the belt that we're looking at. Now, I want you to see, here's the picture of a Roman legionnaire. We're going to work our way through all these different parts, but you can see the belt of that Roman legionnaire. And it serves a couple purposes. The first thing I want you to understand is in Roman armor, the belt is primary. Okay, it's primary. It served this purpose of organizing and keeping your stuff in place. That's what it's there for. But this is the piece of armor that even if you aren't wearing anything else, you're wearing this. Okay, for your Roman legionnaire, this was worn at all times, even without the other armor. And it's there, again, to organize things. It's there to keep a couple of things in place. The sword that we're going to talk about, it helps keep that breastplate in its proper place. It adds, there's a layer of protection to it, okay, when it comes to key parts of the soldier's body. So it's doing all those things. So it's primary. The second thing is, it's really there, its intention is to allow that soldier to be ready for action. Okay, it's intended to allow you to be ready for action. And so literally Ephesians 6:14, if we were just to take those Greek words and just one by one go through them, literally what we're told in Ephesians 6:14 is stand firm therefore, having girded your loins with truth. Okay? That's literally what we're being told. Gird your loins with truth. Now we don't say that a lot anymore. I understand, okay? But that word gird, you hear about it maybe in some other ways. Okay, maybe you know of a girdle. Okay, again, not as popular as they once were. Okay, now we have Spanx, but there used to be girdles. Okay, I do know what that is. So there's girdle, or you have a girder, right? You have a girder. So in construction, you have girders, and these are giant beams that other beams are then attached to. These are meant to provide structure. Okay, they're a major part of providing structure and support. And that's what this belt is meant to do. It's meant to provide support, and it's meant to have you ready for action. And so in Luke 12:35, Jesus, as he's talking about another thing that's really important in terms of being ready, he says in Luke 12:35, be ready for service. Be ready for service. But literally what he says, again, is gird your loins for service. Gird your loins for action. That's what he's saying. It's one and the same. Be ready to go. Be ready for action. And so that's what the belt was meant to do in the life of a Roman soldier. So what does that mean for God's armor? Well, in God's armor, the belt of truth is very simply this. The belt of truth is Jesus. I want us to understand that. We're going to look, again, at the sword of the Spirit and the word of God. And these two things go together. But in God's armor, the belt of truth is Jesus. He is the organizing principle that puts life in order. Just as the belt for the Roman soldier was meant to put their soldier life in order. This belt is meant to organize our lives. Now, a lot of times when you start to talk about this idea of following God and who God is and whether I should believe in him and maybe give my life, devote my life to him, and just all the things that go into maybe claiming to be a Christian, a lot of times we start to talk about the comparison of ways to God. So somebody might say, well, you know, really, this is all kind of unnecessary. You know, when it comes to the things of God, we're really just talking about one mountain, and there's just a lot of paths. And you might go up one side of the mountain, and it looks like your side is the right way to get there, and I'm coming up the other side of the mountain, and my way looks like the best. But ultimately, we're all going to meet there at the top, and it'll all be the same. So your path doesn't really matter. Others sometimes compare these different ways to God as an elephant. Like there's this one elephant that comes into town in this village of a lot of blind people, and the blind people then they say, well, there's these many parts, right? It's one elephant, it's got many parts, and they begin to feel one part of that elephant and begin to describe the elephant only based on the one part that they feel. And so they have in their mind, well, you know what, God's like this. And you think he's like that, but really there's all just one big elephant. And it sounds so noble, it sounds so kind of philosophical and intelligent to say this. The problem is, somebody knows it's an elephant. So it doesn't matter what I compare it to, there is an actual objective truth. There's an elephant. And so we get in this idea that, you know, well, we're just blind men doing our best to describe the part we found. But again, there's problems with these things. Again, one of them is someone knows there's an actual elephant. The other thing is when it comes to Christianity, there's an agreement that there is only one king of the mountain. Right? That's right. There is only one king that will truly be there at the top of that mountain. But the claim of Christianity is there is only one path that gets us to the top. This is what Jesus himself says, okay? You think it's exclusive. You think it's just not with the times. The problem is then you've got, the problem then becomes with Jesus. Because Jesus himself makes this claim, John 14:6, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And his followers, his first followers, understood this. And so they say in Acts 4:12, there's salvation in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given to people by which we must be saved. And so then later Christians are told this, 1 John 5:20, if you're a Christ follower, we are in the true one. That is, in his Son, Jesus Christ. He is the true God and eternal life. So very early on, this is the claim that's being made. And what separated Christianity at this time is not that they had some other idea about who God was. The thing that separated them was that they weren't just adding one God to many. They were saying, no, all these other gods, They are not the one true God. There is only one true God. And so when we talk truth, we talk about the belt of truth, what we're talking about is exclusively Jesus. And he is the one who brings life together. Our problem, though, is what was described in John 5:39. He said to a group, he said, you pore over the scriptures because you think you have eternal life in them, and yet they testify about me. But you're not willing to come to me so that you may have life. Jesus is making the point here. He's talking to a group of Jewish followers. And he says, look, you're following the ways of Judaism. So you're following the Old Testament. And that's fine. But you think that the Old Testament is just a bunch of rules to lead you to eternal life. But those things you found in the Old Testament were leading you to me. That was all pointing to me. I am the truth is what Jesus is saying. And this is the problem. Whether it's Old Testament scriptures or any number of things, we pore over all kinds of other stuff, thinking that in other things we'll find eternal life. But ultimately, life is only found in Jesus. And so the Christian life is described as getting dressed properly. Ephesians 4, listen to this. Ephesians 4, earlier in this letter, Paul describes the Christian life. He says, that is not how you came to know Christ, assuming you heard about him and were taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus. You were taught to take off your former way of life, the old self that is corrupted by deceitful desires, to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to put on the new self, the one created according to God's likeness in righteousness and purity of the truth. Here we're told to get dressed differently. Put on Jesus. In fact, that's the very thing we're told in Romans 13. Let us discard the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Now catch this. Here we're told, put on the armor of light, and then later, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. So when we're getting dressed, this primary part of this armor, the belt of truth, the thing that you have on no matter what, the thing that's organizing and pulling all of life together, is Jesus himself. That's the starting point. If we don't start there, none of the armor makes sense. It doesn't work for us to just throw on a helmet. If we don't understand the primary path to knowing God and walking with God. And so in God's armor, the belt of truth is Jesus. And what it does is it keeps us from getting unexpectedly snarled or confused. It's meant to help us go through life without getting tripped up, without getting confused about what really matters, about what life's really all about. Truth is intended to help us walk that line. And so we're told in 1 Peter 1:13, therefore, with your minds ready for action. Right? Again, there's this idea, be ready, be girded, be sober-minded. Set your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. We're to have a singular focus that this is where our life is found. This is how our life is lived. We're told in 2 Timothy 2, where this idea of being a soldier is, this comparison is made again. Share in suffering as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No one serving as a soldier gets entangled in the concerns of civilian life. He seeks to please the commanding officer. The idea is that if Jesus is the truth and our lives are ordered around him, then we are singularly devoted to him. We understand that all these other things that compete for our interests and our ultimately our worship and our allegiance, they've got to be set aside. They've got to be put away. So the belt is intended to keep us walking the straight and narrow. So, third question then. For which of the devil's schemes is it especially useful? Second question. For which of the devil's schemes is it especially useful? Well, it's useful when we're tempted to compromise. Specifically here, we need the belt of truth because we are tempted to compromise. We're tempted to sort of loosen that belt when it comes to the truth, right? To get loose on the truth. We see this all the way back in the very beginning. Genesis 3:1, when mankind succumbs to this rebellion against their maker. This is how it goes down. It says, now the serpent, this is describing the enemy, Satan. The serpent was the most cunning of all the wild animals that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, did God really say, you can't eat from any tree in the garden? Did God really say? Does God really have, you know, the market? Has he cornered the market on truth? That's the temptation. It's to compromise. It's to think that God's way really isn't the best way, and that maybe there's this greater chance that God's just going to rip us off, that he's going to call us to something, but really he's holding out on us. So this temptation to compromise comes, and this plays out over time with offers of freedom. It's this offer that seems like there's a better way, that there's better, more freedom found in defying God's ways, that there's another way of pulling life together apart from God. I want you to listen to author Sam Storms as he describes this strategy. He says, demons have a strategy for this world, for your church, and for your life. The heart of this strategy is to lie to you and make it sound like the truth. They aim to convince you that following Jesus is stupid, anti-intellectual, on the wrong side of history, and contrary to the prevailing winds of enlightened culture. They go on, following Jesus will only rob you of sensual and sexual pleasures that you deserve to experience. This is the kind of lie that comes. And so you're tempted to compromise. You're tempted to get loose on the truth and give in. But usually, we experience the demonic in subtle ways. So I want you to hear, this is a little bit more extended. Author D.A. Carson, he's very helpful in describing how this strategy plays out in us individually. Okay, listen to what he describes. He says, most believers are not enticed into sin by the prospect of committing great evil. Okay? Far from it. They rationalize their way into committing evil by seeing in it some kind of good, or at very least by blocking out the evil dimensions. They cheat on their income tax, not because stealing and lying are gross sins, but because they tell themselves there is so much government waste, because government takes more than its share, because everybody's doing it, because no one will ever know. They gossip about neighbors and friends, not out of conscious disobedience to God, but because they feel they are passing on truth, the result of mature discernment. They nurture bitterness and hate against a spouse or a fellow believer, not because they hunger to ignore the unambiguous warnings in Scripture against bitterness and hate, but because they are persuaded their emotions are not evil after all, but simply justifiable instances of righteous indignation. See, this is, it's subtle. This temptation comes to compromise. And it's not coming all at once with some grand idea that, man, I'm going to go and just, you know, become a hardened criminal. It comes in these subtle, different little ways. And the result is disorder. The result is these false freedoms that ultimately lead to disaster. And so we're tempted to compromise. And then there's this other part of that temptation. We're tempted to compromise and then be put in a spot where we're hiding in shame. That's the way this plays out. You compromise, and then you're tempted to go hide in shame. This is what happens, again, going all the way back, Genesis 3:8. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze, and they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. When we defy God, there is reason for shame. There's reason for shame. God's ways are good and right, not just because he happened to say them, but because he is good and right. These are his ways. To defy those things is something worthy of shame. I mean, we should be ashamed of that. However, the temptation comes to then not, instead of coming to God to find the solution to our shame, is to just go and hide. To be broken, to be pulled apart from him. And so again, this is the way this plays out time and again, is that we are tempted to compromise and then to hide. And that's often the experience we have. We do something wrong. We know we've blown it. And then we get really worked over because we just get pushed deeper and deeper into that shame and thinking, man, okay, he's not going to be okay with me this time. Just, I've blown it. I need to go and find another way. I need to go pull life together some other way. Because not because God isn't good enough, but I'm just not good enough. And we start down this cycle. Meanwhile, we've let go of the truth. So here's the third question. How did Jesus use the belt of truth to defeat Satan, sin, and death? Okay, before we talk about how do we then do battle here, it's important for us to recognize this is something that Jesus himself has already done. See, what Jesus did is he ordered his life around faithful obedience to the Father's will. He ordered his life around faithful obedience to the Father's will. What does that mean? Well, there's this prophecy. Isaiah 11:5 describes the Messiah who was to come, and he's described like this. Righteousness will be a belt around his hips. Faithfulness will be a belt around his waist. Righteousness, faithfulness. You say, well, it's a belt of truth, and that's a belt of righteousness and faithfulness. Yes, but this was pointing to the fact that there would be one who would come and embody both, and in whom truth would be found. And so, author Ian Duguid tells us this, the toxic effects of the fall brought about by the first Adam listening to Satan's lies would be reversed by this second Adam, an heir of the line of David, whose foundational qualities are truth and faithfulness. Truth and faithfulness. And so we see that Jesus, he comes and he establishes his credentials as the truth because of his righteousness and faithfulness. 2 Corinthians 5:21, he made the one who did not know sin to be sin for us so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Jesus was perfectly righteous. but he gave us his righteousness. And then Hebrews 12:2, keeping our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, for the joy that lay before him, he endured the cross. He was faithful. That's what he's saying. He was faithful, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Jesus was perfectly righteous. He was perfectly faithful. And it's in his life, as the one who is truly God and truly man, who has brought about this possibility of us being reconciled. And so he himself orders his life around faithful obedience to the Father's will. He shows us what it looks like to wear the belt of truth so that then we can wear it ourselves. He makes it possible for this belt to be ours. He makes it possible for us to know him. That's what he has accomplished by being the one who wore righteousness and faithfulness as a belt. So then how do we fight against the enemy's schemes? How do we use the belt of truth to fight against enemy schemes? Here's the big idea. We've been saying it all along. Organize your life around Jesus. Organize your life around Jesus. Some of you may know the name John Wooden. He was a famous basketball coach, won 10 NCAA basketball titles with UCLA Bruins. Just great, great coach, all kinds of accolades and awards. He would start every season as he was getting guys going, as they were doing training camp and they're getting the season ready. They would start every season with a lesson on socks and shoes. Every season would start with just, guys, okay, here's a sock, here's a shoe, here's what we do with these, okay? And he would teach them how to put on their socks and how to put on their shoes. Now, I'm not sure if he was a sock, sock, shoe, shoe guy or a sock, shoe guy. I don't know, okay? But this lesson was an organizing principle for his success. I mean, it was really foundational for a lot of what made John Wooden and his team so successful. And the big idea that he was trying to get across is that there is a greater truth than your talent. He brought together some of the greatest basketball players who have ever played the game. And what he had to help them understand is that there is a greater truth than your talent. You see, the very best team can be undone by an undisciplined approach. Whether that's something as small as an untied shoelace or an unprotected big toe that gets a blister. He was trying to help them understand that. You can be as talented as you are, but you can be undone by these little things. There's a greater truth than your talent. Now, there's this far more important than a battle on the basketball court is the one that we face. And this far greater truth is available to us. Jesus is the truth. But it's got to be foundational. It's got to be primary in our lives. Jesus is the organizing principle of life. And like a belt, he pulls things together and he holds everything in place. That's what he wants to do. But he's not a concept. This is important. I mean, I'm using this word, the organizing principle. But Jesus isn't a concept. He's a person. And he's a person that you and I can know. And so to organize our life around him means that we seek to know him. I mean, seek to know him. Not just know about him, but to know him. Seek to actually know who he is. So we're told, he tells us, John 17:3, this is eternal life. You know that you can experience eternal life right now. It's not something we just wait for. We'll know it fully someday. But as Christ followers, this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and the one you have sent, Jesus Christ. This is Jesus speaking. He says, this is eternal life, is knowing God, knowing Jesus. And so then Paul says elsewhere to the letter to the Philippians, he says, I consider everything to be a loss in view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. He's talking about knowing Jesus through living life, trusting Jesus, through whatever he was going to face. He says, look, I'm going to suffer. He's writing from prison. He says, look, I know what it is to suffer for Jesus. But far more valuable than anything I'm going through is the fact that what I'm going through is an opportunity for me to know Jesus himself. That's what my life is all oriented around. And so it is for us. We fight this battle by starting with, man, I want to know Jesus. I'm going to spend each day seeking to know and walk with him. And so that helps us prepare for when the temptation to compromise comes. Which is to say, then, the second thing is you organize your life around Jesus by continuing to check the truth of what you think, do, and say. That's what we're called to do. Keep checking the truth. And so Paul actually says earlier in Ephesians 5, he gives us a picture of what this looks like. Ephesians 5:6, he says, let no one deceive you with empty arguments. He goes on in Ephesians 5:8, walk as children of light. Ephesians 5:11, don't participate in the fruitless works of darkness, but instead expose them. In Ephesians 5:15, pay careful attention then, how you walk, not as unwise people, but as wise. This idea is just, as you're going through life, pay attention that you're focused on what is true, that you're seeking to know the truth and walk in that truth. And so you check, what am I saying? What am I thinking about? Is this, the thoughts that are running through my head, are they actually the truth about who God is? Are they truthful about what's going on? Maybe you say, you know what, this situation, yes, that's what's happening, but does it jive with the big picture truth of who God is and what he's done and what he's promised? So I orient myself, you orient yourself around the truth of who God is and what he's done. And you don't let yourself get slipped up walking down these paths of just living in lies, being tempted to compromise. Third part of this, just practically, and we're going to look at this every single week, just something that our kids have learned really well. We teach this down in kids' ministry. It's this practice of hey, say, pray, obey. Very simply, here's what it involves. Hey, that's just recognizing, man, the battle is on. A lot of times we get tripped up because we just don't recognize that there's a battle. We don't recognize, man, I'm down the road in these thoughts. I didn't even realize, man, I'm just getting worked over here. And I'm living in falsehood because I didn't even recognize what was happening. So it starts with just recognizing the battle. Then how do we respond? Well, speak the truth. That's where having God's word stored up, knowing what God's word has said, is really beneficial to us. That's why we learn to memorize God's word. Not so we can, you know, get some kind of awards. We don't hand out those awards. But so that we're ready, we know how to speak the truth. Hey, wait, this doesn't match with what is truthful. Then we pray. This is understanding, I don't do this on my own. I need God's help. And then finally, obey. You take the next step. You just take the next step that's needed. And if you think, well, I'm gonna take one step and then the battle's just gonna go away, no, not often. A lot of times, you're gonna take the next step and then the next battle is going to be there. The next thing to deal with is going to be there. And you've got to continue to recognize the battle, recognize the truth, ask God for help, take another step. And at some point, Scripture tells us you resist the devil and he'll flee. But it doesn't necessarily all happen at once. So I want to encourage you to learn to walk in these ways. I've given you a few next steps, some things to think about. One of those, again, is begin practicing this. This is new to you? Hey, say, pray, obey. Man, begin practicing. If you're like, hey, I tried that, I'm not really sure. Well, keep working at it. Ask others. But continue to work on this. I also want to commend to you this book, The Story of Reality. If you're just wondering about, hey, how does this whole big picture of Christianity fit together? How do I understand this, kind of just the truth? This is a great starting spot to really understand what is the Bible all about, what does it say about our world and how it came about and where it's headed and everything in between. That's kind of the subtitle of the book. It's very readable, a really helpful resource for understanding this big picture on the truth. And again, we're going to be memorizing as we walk through this series, Ephesians 6, 10 through 18. So here today I gave you Ephesians 6, 12. I commend to you, continue to memorize God's word as a way of learning to fight the battle. Let's pray together. Father, thank you that you haven't left us alone in this battle. We thank you that you've given us your strength, given us your instruction, and we thank you, Jesus, that you are the truth, that you've made a way for us to be reconciled to God. And I pray that you would help us to learn to walk wisely. Help us to recognize when the battle's raging, not give in, but also help us recognize when we've not fought like we should have, to know that your grace is endless, and it is sufficient, and that you can be trusted to pick us up and help us to continue to stand. Lord, we need you, and we pray for your help. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father, not my will, but yours be done. Father, not
is our prayer today, that his will would be done in each of our lives. We look to him as the way, the truth, and the life, and we worship. Join with us as we sing our last song.
Into marvelous light I'm running, out of darkness, out of shame. By the cross you are the truth, you are the life, you are the way. I once was fatherless, a stranger with no hope, but kindness wakened me, humbled me from my sleep. Your love, it beckons deep, a call to come and die. By grace now I will come, take this life, take your life. Sin has lost its power, death has lost its sting. From the grave you've risen victoriously.
Hey guys, real quick as we wrap up, a couple things I want to let you know about coming up here in just a couple weeks, especially for families. We've got Spooktacular Family Movie Night. So a meetup happening Friday, October 28th. They're going to watch It's a Great Pumpkin, Charlie Brown, do some s'mores and other fun things. So I want to invite you to check that out. You can do that online and let them know you're coming. And then coming up a couple weeks after that, right here, we're going to do Pancakes, Presents, and PJs, Saturday, November 12th. Have pancake breakfast. We're going to show a Christmas movie. And then kids are going to be able to make gifts for their family members. We're going to have that all set up where they can do that. There'll be door prizes, other things going on. So love for you to invite, for you to come, invite others that you know that might enjoy being a part of that. We'd love for them to be here. But that, those two things are coming up. Today, as we pray, we're going to pray for one of our local community partners, Level Up Kids, who do great work of helping kids in the Northland get eye care and dental care. And so join me as we pray for Level Up Kids and their leadership. Father, thank you for the part we get to play in seeing kids helped, see families helped who need the extra assistance. We pray that you would give the leadership of Level Up Kids great wisdom to run that organization in a way that really benefits kids and families all across the Northland and beyond. And we thank you again for the part we get to play financially in supporting that. We pray that their work would continue to expand. More and more kids would be benefited. And again, we pray that you would help them to do their work with great integrity and to honor you in the things that they do. We pray that you would help those that are a part of that leadership that don't know you to come to know you. And we pray for your help and guidance in Jesus' name. With that, may the love of the Father, may the grace of Jesus, may the comfort of the Holy Spirit be with you now and until Jesus comes back. You guys have a fantastic week. We'll see you next time.